What you know about Keats?
What you know about Keats?
What you know about Keats
in the Grecian urn?
What you know about Keats?
What you know about Keats?
What you know about Keats?
Sit back and learn. What you know about Keats?
I think he was a poet.
Exactly. What's his story?
I was hoping you might know it.
A famous British dude who was so prolific. He died at 25 and his O's were sick.
But owed you mean a shout out?
Basically like props to nightingales and urns. This dude wrote a lot.
Was he famous in his time?
No, kind of like Poe or Melville. History would prove he was dope.
Welcome to episode 27 of Bedroom Beethovens, a podcast that breaks down stories with various music producers accompanied by songs and melodies, documenting growth through their 10,000-hour journey. Think of this as a podcast, or you could think of it as a masterclass. However you view it, it's a conversations with masters of their craft. Next up on deck, Mega Ran. People refer to him as a nerdcore artist, but I gotta be honest with you, I don't really like that term because it kind of takes away from the seriousness of his skill. Now, that's just my opinion, and I'm not sure if he embraces it, but if he does, there's nothing wrong with that. But however you want to categorize him, above all else, you have to just say he's dope.
Truth is beauty. Beauty is truth.
Peace.
Yeah.
Yeah, fools.
What?
He left his job as a teacher several years ago to pursue his dream of being a full-time MC. Mission accomplished. I've been a fan for years and years and years, and I'm honored to host him. But before I get to the meat and potatoes of the podcast, I implore you to check out Wicca website, bedroombeethovens.com. There you'll find all the goodies, YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and the Patreon. Support me, man. This is a labor of love. I do it for free so I can bring you these conversations. Go to patreon.com/bedroombeethovens. It's all there. So if you're a fan of the show, fan of what I do, please head there and show your love. And if you feel so inclined, head on over to Apple Podcasts and drop your boy a 5-star review. All right. I am your host, Cello. And
it's the Bedroom Beethoven Podcast.
Are the very first person that I ever reached out to do this podcast with me. The very first one.
Really?
Yeah. For people that don't know, you gave me the old, sorry, random guy, try again in 6 months when you're worth your, no, I'm kidding. But you are super friendly. You're just a very busy guy. And you told me to hit you back in a few months. And when people say that, I always think in the back of my mind, like, they're going to forget. But when someone does follow up, you're like, oh shit, they must've been serious or they really wanted me. And that's true, man. I've been kind of chasing you for the better part of 2019.
Wow. I mean, I'm honored. First of all, second, yeah, man, when I tell people to follow up, you know, it's because I need them to follow up. You know, I'm usually in the middle of something and I'm like, hey, once things even out for me a little bit, or if I have something to talk about, like if there's a new album or a new project, then that's the time that I would love to do, you know, interviews and things. So when I ask people to check back in, it's not like a, hey, get out of here, kid, you know.
It's like, hey, what you been up to? You'd be like, binge watching Game of Thrones because I'm not on tour, not releasing music. So come back in a couple months when I have something to talk about.
Exactly. I need something to talk about. Also, I get a little weary, I'm not going to lie, when people tell me that they're starting a new thing. And I'm I know as a person who has started and stopped hundreds of things in my life that it can be difficult to continue, you know, on the process and on the road of the struggles of beginning something and starting up from humble beginnings and then continuing. So for me, my favorite number is 9. So I always joke and say that I'll do someone's 9th podcast, but I won't do their first episode.
That works. Well, I think you're around 28, 29. So
dang,
even better.
That's even better.
So how was Comic-Con, man?
It was great. Hectic, but it was fun. This is something that every year I get to it and I'm like, oh, here we go again. Comic-Con, yada, 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 yada. And then I get there and I see amazing cosplay. I see people I know or fans that are super excited to see me. And then all the excitement comes right back. And yeah, it was a great time. You know, beautiful weather in San Diego, not much else you can ask for. And then seeing great panels, getting to play some games, great food out in San Diego. And so, yeah, I had a really, really good time.
Yeah, the big thing for me was Mahershala Ali being Blade. I don't know the guy personally, but he has that Denzel Man on Fire quality where he's scary just by being quiet and stern and just looking at you.
Absolutely. I felt a lot of Blade in him during Luke Cage, the Cottonmouth.
For sure, yeah. That's okay, a good parallel.
I could see it once I saw that role. I was like, oh, he could do this.
Isn't it crazy? He used to be a hip hop artist, Prince Ali.
It's wild, man. I went down the rabbit hole maybe a month ago through all his music, and he was dope. And like, he was just like, yeah, I'm gonna do something else.
Just like that. Yeah.
Like, he got signed to Hyro, like Hyro's label. So this is like super lyrical cats who respected him. And yeah, man, they know him very well in the Bay Area scene as like a dope MC who like loves hip hop culture.
And part of me wants like Wesley Snipes to be in that whole thing, but another part of me knows, like, just from what I've been reading, like, he's been kind of toxic. Like, he would tell people to call him Blade in the third person on set, or I read that he referred to Ryan Reynolds as that cracker. Tell that cracker to learn his lines. Get that cracker out of my line of sight. And it's literally mind blowing the stuff that he was able to get away with. And I really believe it started a thing in Hollywood where if a black guy got out of line, they replaced him with the quickness, which is why we have Don Cheadle as War Machine instead of Terrence Howard. That's my theory.
I cannot really refute that theory because it seems that way, you know. And the worst thing is for you to get that reputation as a, you know, troublesome actor on set, because then it's like you're out of there. And and with Marvel stuff, like, who would have known, you know, what was that, 15, 20 years ago, that the Marvel movie empire would grow into what it is, you know? And those people you crapped on the way up, you know, or looking like, yeah, see you later. Yeah. you know, Ryan Reynolds of all people, like, this is Deadpool, you know what I mean? Who like legit said like, yeah, I wouldn't come back if they did another Blade. Like, that's crazy.
That's rough. But I think they're going to get it right. I'm a big fan of Blade too. Blade Trinity, man, not so much, but mm-hmm. I think they'll get it right. But what got me even more excited was you caught up with DMC of Run DMC, like at Comic-Con. And did he know you beforehand? Like, what did y'all talk about?
This was crazy. Just a series of coincidences. I was at a booth just doing like a signing, meet and greet kind of thing. Geekscape is the name of the company that runs our podcast. And they also were sharing the table with DMC. And I'm like, wait, what? Like, what are the odds here? So I come and sit down. He's sitting down. And the other guy, and DMC says, yo, you're the guy they've been telling me about. Like, you do the video game flips and stuff. Yo, that's crazy. Tell me more. Sit down. And I'm like, what is my life right now? So yeah. DMC's like, yo, man, my kid is deep in the video games and he wants to DJ. Like, tell me more about this. Like, this is awesome. And then he starts telling me all these crazy stories about his love for comic books and how all that stuff has come together for him. And man, it was just crazy just sitting there, just chopping it up with a freaking legend, you know. And it was super down to earth, man, mad chill. And we just kind of swapped stories. He was just like, so what made you do this? And how, you know, how is this going for you? And how does the hip hop community treat you? And how does this, you know, and then he would like relay it to stories of him coming up and being like, yeah, man, when I was into these comic books, it was this way. And, you know, and it was just awesome. And I learned a lot just from that conversation. Most importantly, to be humble and willing to talk and learn from anybody.
Yeah, you know what's crazy is I heard that, like, when he was working, when Run DMC was working with Aerosmith, they didn't even know who Aerosmith was. They just knew, I think it was like track 4 on their album, we want to get on that. And I think like Rick Rubin like just orchestrated the whole thing. So that's pretty crazy that you had this legendary moment in hip hop that was like they weren't even really aware of the impact it was going to have. He always did the rock rap thing. They just didn't know it was going to like take a life on its own and be like this cornerstone in hip hop back in the 80s. And I don't know, it was almost like a happy accident.
Yeah. I think the best successes are usually that way. You know, you're like, you have no idea of the impact it can make. And then boom, I mean, that's literally why I'm here talking to you right now. It's like having a crazy idea and then having it almost become larger than yourself, you know, which is how Walk This Way did for those guys.
Yeah. And I mean, and this is just me speaking personally, like when I hear the label like nerdcore, it makes me think of you as like less hard on the mic than you are. I remember, and let me explain. I remember like Gym Class Heroes came out with New Friend Request like a decade ago. And I thought the band was like a parody band based off that song. And I didn't realize like, oh, these guys are legit. Or when I was a kid, I remember seeing Foo Fighters Learn to Fly and they were joking around the video, or I'll see like Tenacious D has like Jack Black, you know, acting a fool. And then I have to remind myself, like, just because there's humor or you're not talking about shooting up the club, you should and be taken serious. And, you know, again, me personally, I don't like the nerdcore label. I just think you're dope. And I just think that you should be recognized as dope. You know, how do you view it? Because I don't know if that term like boxes you in or, you know, because you had your fan base of random and now you have your fan base of mega ran, and you kind of combine the two. You know what I mean? I like chip hop, though. I do like that term.
I've like skirted around and danced around the term nerdcore. We've had a complicated relationship over the years. And then I settled on the term chip hop, which came from a band called Optimus Rhyme back in the day, who combined hip hop music with chip sounds. And I saw the term one day in like a bio on one of their websites, and I was like, oh wait, that's it, that's what I do. So people have called it Nintendo core, people have called it, you know, nerd rap, geek rap, whatever. I think that chip hop is more inclusive of what I do. I mean, when you think nerdcore, you think raps about nerdy things or nerdy style of rap. But I'm glad you brought up those examples of Tenacious D and
a long ass fucking time ago in a town called Kickapoo. They lived a humble family, religious through and through. But yay, there was a black sheep, and he knew just what to do. His name was Young JP, and he refused to step in line. A vision he did see of fucking rocking all the time. He wrote a tasty jam, and all the planets did align.
Other folks where you're like, oh, I thought this was a joke. And then you're like, oh, wait, they actually are talented and good at making music, you know? And I think that's the part that people forget is that, you know, I am a musician first, and a lot of us are, and that it's okay to include humor into your music, but it can also box you in where people will think, oh, you're the joke band, you know? And we've gone through that with nerdcore. People assume it's just like white guys and pocket protectors and thick glasses, you know, rapping about D&D. But I think that over the years, it has expanded and become literally anything. I mean, I was listening to JPEG Mafia, you know, and I hear a ton of wrestling references or video game sound effects and things like that. And I'm like, oh, this is the same stuff I'm doing, except it's not called nerdcore, you know? So I've run from it, then I've embraced it, and then I've run from it again, and then I've learned now to accept it, and that I will have to explain the term to people, and that the term is more inclusive of a much more like deep range of things than what people might think. So I don't really mind. And I think the bottom line is customers, consumers, potential listeners, they kind of need a thing. They need a word. They need a phrase. They need a descriptor that will help them find it. And if nerdcore is it, then, you know, so be it. I can't necessarily help that. I was listening to Bus Driver the other day, and then I found out that there is a new genre tied to Bus Driver's music called Escape Room. I had never even heard of this. Are you familiar with this?
I have never heard of that.
See, like, there's a weird subgenre of almost every type of rap, which I think is dope because it used to just be rap. I'm all about it if it makes people listen. Now, same time, I get fans coming up to me who say, you're the only rapper I listen to. And I'm like, oh, you need to stop. You gotta pick up some MF Doom. You gotta pick up some Deltron. You gotta listen to a lot of other stuff.
Who fuses the music with no illusions? Producing the blueprints, clueless automator. The final laws of nature. Electronic monolith, throw a jam upon the disc. The futuristic loop it with the quickness. Hyper-producing, hydrogen fusion liquids. Keep your distance.
You know, because there's more good music out there. And I get the one, like the thing that sounds like a compliment, but really isn't, where people say, yo, I love rap. Or I hate rap, but I love you. Like, yo, you're dope. But at rap, I hate it. And I'm like, hello, fly. Like, this is rap. Like, you know, I am rapping. Like, I have to say that. And I make sure to do it at concerts and things. That's, make sure it's a learning opportunity. Because I realize I am a lot of people's gateway into hip hop because there's no profanity in my music. It might come from an easier to swallow place. But I was brought up with Kool G Rap, Beastie Boys, Run DMC, you know, LL Cool J. And I think that people who listen to me need to know my influences as well. So I use it as a teaching moment, you know, where I'd be like, yo, this is what you got to listen to. And when you listen to all these, come back to me and tell me what you think, you know.
This was like, what, 92, 93, when you first wrote your first rap, influenced by Gangstar, Master Ace. But what about Philly, like The Roots, Schoolie D, Beanie Siegel, Fresh Prince? Like, did you connect with like products of your environment, or it was just like a love of just East Coast hip hop in general?
I think it was East Coast in general, but 92, like, you know, The Roots, definitely Schoolie D, this guy named Cool C, EST, Three Times Dope. Philadelphia had a great hip hop scene where, but a lot of it was like hardcore stuff. You know, we had a Schoolie D, that PSK, like it was a lot of really aggressive, you know, like hustler based rap music. But then I would hear EST, Three Times Dope. This is some of my favorite stuff because it was funky and it was, I won't say like soft, but it was definitely smoother. And it let me know that hip hop could be anything. And then Run DMC, and then LL Cool J, when I heard like him go from I Need Love to I'm Bad, I was just like, oh my gosh, this is the greatest rapper of all time. Preaching no tar, teaching how to be hard. Take the skin off a snake and split a pea from a pie. You're a novice, I'm noble, and I dissect on my tongue. Not a till of the hunt, you know Abdullah is son. My voice is exact, like racking pinion in a jack. You try to like, how can he convince me that he's in love, but also convince me that he'll beat me up? Like, at the same time, you know? So that, right, to me, LL Cool J is my most influential rapper to me because of his versatility. And it just let me know that hip-hop could do anything for you because it could make you feel so many emotions. It wasn't just feeling like the toughest, coolest, best-dressed, slickest guy, but you could also share emotion. And that was probably the first time I really understood that. And that's when I started writing, was kind of hopped off all that stuff. You know, 92, 93 was just an amazing time for hip hop, you know, from the Gangstar to Snoop's first album, Wu-Tang, to then later The Roots. Then so much good stuff was coming out just back to back to back. And we just caught up in the rush and we were just like, I got to write. We got to write some stuff. So we just started writing. And I was with a group. It's funny, we called ourselves The Firm before, like, the Nas group, The Firm. And that was, like, based on the movie. We're like, oh, man, The Firm was such a cool, cool concept. Like, we're a group of, like, professionals, but we're also, like, we get down in secret. And that was kind of our thing. It was, like, a bunch of nerdy cats, and we would all just sit down and write, like, what Gangstar would sound like, I guess, if, you know, if Guru was into video games and comics, you know?
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought up versatility because I don't want people to think like, oh, I'm making a song about AEW wrestling or Jeremy Lin or Mega Man. It's not simply, oh, you know what? Nobody's made a rap song about Forrest Whitaker shopping at a Whole Foods. So I'll make a song about that. I'll go to sleep. And when I wake up, Whole Foods will be in my email waiting to write me a big check. It's about versatility. Not many people can do that.
That's the truth. I think that it's got to be authentic, which is probably the most cliched thing, but especially when you're dealing with people who self-identify as nerds. And I think we're all nerdy about something, whether it's music, sneakers, sports. And true nerds who are passionate about their thing will spot a counterfeit in a second, you know?
Okay, well, talking about authenticity then, like Static Selecta and Big Shug, they sampled Punch Out, Jay-Z and Swiss Beats. Money Cash Hoes was from Golden Axe. talk about this on my show in a previous episode of Ace Da Vinci, where we talk about how the Blueprint 2 sampled a Sierra Leone beat from Wild Arms, like the town music. Wiz Khalifa and Dom Kennedy sampled Chrono Trigger. Now, we know Jay-Z isn't firing up his Genesis console and playing Golden Axe in his free time. So what are your thoughts on rappers rhyming over these samples to make successful songs? Because you're living it. You know the culture. Obviously, if someone's a fan, they can see your authenticity. But, I mean, these are like mainstream artists doing this.
I don't know. I mean, how do we know Jay-Z's not sitting at home like, yo, these graphics are crazy. Yo, that's sticks, you know. I don't know, man. I've fought with this a lot too, where people will ask me like, man, you know, these guys are fronting. They're like, they're stepping into your culture and they're not really living this life. And it's like, well, the Wiz Khalifa one especially pops up to me is that Wiz might not even known about Chrono Trigger. It was the producer who sampled that, brought it to Wiz or got it to Wiz in whatever way. He liked it and rapped on it. I don't think there was any conversation about the video game. It's just a hot beat is a hot beat is a hot beat. And, I don't have any problem with people rapping over hot beats. I mean, it's like before I started sampling video games, I was sampling classical. Now, I might not be the biggest classical fan. I mean, I could tell you a couple of symphonies, but I was sampling it because it sounded good, you know? So a lot of times going back and sampling doesn't necessarily mean you have to be a part of that culture. It's just being able to know how to put sounds together, you know? But I've seen some situations pop up. Timbaland, I believe it was, who sampled, I think it was for a Nelly Furtado track. He sampled a computer game. And gosh, I wish I could remember the guy's name. Maybe he was a Swedish artist. And when it came down to like litigation where the guy was like, dude, like you stole my stuff. Timbaland looked at it like, oh, it was some video game, some dumb game. I don't know. Like just like downplaying video game music and implying that it wasn't music. And I think that that's the important part is that over the years, we've now been able to appreciate video games as art and as a legit form of media, because there's some talented cats who were able to take these very limited sound chips and make these like brilliant soundscapes out of them. So I think that's the number one thing is just that as long as the person recognizes what they're sampling as music and as something that has contributions to the culture, you know, and not just like, oh, it's just something that, I don't know, it just sounded hot, so I just looped it together, you know.
Well, yeah, and you know, Final Fantasy VII came out when I was 12. That kind of started my love affair with video game soundtracks and JRPGs in general. I mean, even what has it been 22 years later? Mm-hmm. But here's the big topic that I wanted to bring up, because I mean, how many interviews have you been in where you're talking about FF7? But I wanted to talk about the representation of black people in Japanese games, because I read your article. You went to Japan, and even in modern times, 2019, being a big black guy is going to garner a lot of general curiosity. And I feel like Barrett had a chance to really do something about that. He was a stereotype of a gruff black man in the English translation of the original game. And I want to point out how the English translation, which was done by, it was just done by one person in 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. He inserted that characterization after the fact. So Barrett's characterization in the remaster even involves exaggerated black dialogue or a dialect. And his retranslated dialogue now emphasizes Americanized ideals about masculinity, but it seems nobody really gets up in arms about it. And this depiction plays into racist assumptions people make about black men, not seeing them as full people, but as like hulking masses of muscle. And maybe they'll provide some wisdom on the side, you know? So, you know, I just thought we would have a little bit more progress. Like the voice acting for Barrett really leans into that Mr. T characterization. I don't know if you know this, 2 years after the release of Final Fantasy was released on Famicom, Square released a RPG called Tom Sawyer. It was an adaptation of Mark Twain's Adventures of Tom Sawyer. And the game has like N-words in there and racial slurs and afros and minstrel shows. And I mean, come on, like stereotypes have a root cause. And I really just don't see why there's no progress with the Barrett character. I mean, because how many black people are we going to get in JRPGs nowadays?
Wow. True. Gosh, I did not know that about the Tom Sawyer thing. Like, so this is a legit NES game that came out?
It was Japanese exclusive RPG.
Oh, and it's still like in the language, like was still like racial slurs and
racial slurs, N-words, like big lips, afros. The characters were like dark as midnight with big white eyes. It was crazy that even in 1989 that this was pushed forward into production.
Wow. Oh my gosh. I need to look that up. That is insane. But however, I wish I could say I was surprised, man. Like I said, I've been to Japan like 7 times and I've been blessed and lucky enough to be there and be appreciated there and play shows there. And some of my best friends live there and they all tell me that, xenophobia out there is real. It's super real. I mean, we think
explain that word for those that don't know.
Okay. So xenophobia, which is a word I've learned from video games, by the way, there was a game called Xenophobe on, I don't remember, NES probably. It was an arcade too, where you had to fight aliens. And that's when I looked it up and I was like, what does that mean? It means a person who's afraid of the unknown. People who look different, people who act different, people who, you know, come from different backgrounds, being afraid of them for various reasons, you know, and maybe thinking they're going to take your jobs, thinking they're going to, you know, rape your women, whatever. That's a huge thing. And I'm sure if it's a huge thing in 2019, it was very huge in 1989 in Japan. There are very few African-Americans or just people of African descent in Japan or in Asia in general. So therefore, when you are seen, there are some stares, there's some questions. And there's probably, you know, just within their normal joking dialect or just conversations, there might be just ridiculously blown out of proportion stories or jokes about people who look different because, you know, Lord knows that's been an American thing for a long time. So I can only imagine how it is there where you just don't see people who look different, who are taller, who are bigger because of that. It's a very, very weird dynamic. I've seen it played out one of two ways. I've seen the general curiosity, which is the staring. Even the women, let's say, just from my perspective of Black males in Japan, Japanese women are very curious because of maybe what they've heard, and they decide to date or, you know, hang out with African Americans because of one, they've heard they're cool, they've heard they can dance, they've heard, you know, they know all the great music, you know, they have certain talents, extracurricular talents even. I don't know. So just based on weird wives' tales that they've heard, they'll attract sometimes an unwanted amount of attention out there. And me, I'm a guy who likes to lay low. So that is odd for me out there. But I had a good friend of mine out there tell me, he's like, you're such a good friend. And I'm like, well, thanks, man. And he's like, my friends told me not to trust you. And I'm like, what? Why? And he's like, I don't know. They told me, and he has like broken English in his email that he wrote. He's like, well, they just told me to never trust Black. And I was like, whoa, it kind of hit me hard. And I was just like, why? You know? And he's like, I don't know. Like, they've just always told me that. Like, I've grown up thinking that you just don't trust people who are Black.
Doesn't that blow you away? Like, I'm so used to like Trump racism, but not like ignorance racism. You know, I read your article and it must put you in a tough position because these Japanese people are coming up to you like you're a Black Totoro and ask if you're made of chocolate, but you can't get mad because it comes from a place of ignorance and not hatred.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
It's very weird. But yeah, this is something that, I mean, just even at a general level, Americans have a tough time adjusting with, you know, society in Japan. And a lot of friends I know who go out there, they have a difficult time because they're very much based in tradition. And America, I think, has, you know, as weird as things are at the top, you know, we've come so far, I think, in the past 50 to 100 years, you know, and so when people try to take those freedoms of speech and expression to Japan, they're often met with just like fear. And I remember a friend telling me that he would, during his like work meetings, he would raise his hand and have comments, have suggestions on how to make things run smoother. And they would look at that as disrespect and be like, no, like, who do you think you are coming over here trying to speak up and tell us that we're doing things wrong and yada, yada. And they really, like, from then on, he was kind of on the outs with his company because he just offered suggestions, you know. So that's something that just isn't you know, it's just a societal difference. And I've noticed that with a lot of different things out there. But overall, I feel like I said, I love it there. And it isn't coming from a place of hatred. You know, it's just a fact of, you know, just ignorance. And as more people, continue to travel out there and back and forth, things will eventually smooth out. But I think that, you know, as much as we complain about, you know, relations here, I think that they've got probably just as far to go in other countries. So just something to think about for perspective's sake.
Yeah, it was an important article. You just offered up very important commentary. I think you're ahead of your time. The Miles Morales track, only a core group of people knew about that. And then Into the Spider-Verse comes out and people are like, ah, yeah, Black Spider-Man. And then Logic comes out with a song, Black Spider-Man. And I'm like, yo, Mega Ran did that for people years ago. And now y'all are just getting hip to it.
Just getting hip to it. Man, gosh, don't get me started. The majority of, I mean, we expect mainstream, you know, hip hop to catch things kind of late in general. The record industry in general is playing catch up, it seems. And so, yeah, when we come up with these ideas and they're just for our select group of people who know, you know, we're not throwing millions of dollars of promotions behind it. We're just kind of doing our thing. And like, it's funny that I met Logic a few years ago. I guess he was putting out that incredible true story or something like that. Right. And he had Steve Bloom, an anime voice actor, narrate his record, which I thought was really cool. And talking to him about it, he was just like, yeah, man, I've been in the anime for years, you know, and I really want to start doing I want to combine anime, video games, comic books with hip hop, because nobody's doing that, yo. And I was like, you know, allow me to inform you, there's been people doing this for 10 years. There's this thing called nerdcore. It's like, yo, I heard that word before, yo, but I just never knew what it was, you know? And I'm like, yeah, we've been kind of doing that, which is it's dope that you want to take it to the mainstream. And, you know, I hope that it is accepted, you know, and if this is what you really love, then yeah, you should do it. But I remember having that conversation and him being like, yo, cause then nobody's doing this. Like, yo, I'm thinking ahead of the game, you know? And I'm like, yeah. But to me, one Google would show you that this has been done, you know? And that's where I looked at it. Before I started the first Mega Man album in 2007, I Googled Mega Man hip hop to make sure that no one had ever done this. I Googled video game hip hop to see what had already been out there. And the closest I found was a band called The Megas who do video game music covers with rock songs. And they'll add lyrics about the boss or about the stage that they're on. And the Proto Men who are do these epic power rock ballads about the universe of Mega Man, but not, you know, specifically about events in the games. But it's loosely based on that universe. And so those are the closest I could find. I was like, oh, nobody's doing this with hip hop. Then let me try it, you know. But again, you know, we have so much information at our fingertips. And just a Google away will usually give you the answer, which is that somebody already did it.
Well, before I respond to that, before I forget, I want to thank you because words like racism have a tendency to shut down conversations and have all parties retreating to their respective foxholes. So thank you for addressing those issues. But to respond to the Logic stuff, you know, I think you can speak on this as you know, as a mainstream guy trying to bring all these quote unquote nerdy elements into music. Like when you were teaching 12 and 13 year olds as a teacher, for people that don't know, he was Mega Ran was a teacher. Like, what were some of the positive trends that you noticed in today's youth? Because 95% of the things kids got bullied for 10 years ago, or maybe when you were teaching, now it's accepted. You know, that the one Iron Man movie single-handedly made it cool to like comics and stuff, because if the captain of the football team goes to see Avengers Endgame, hey, that crosses the chasm. If Logic's making a song about anime, all of a sudden it's cool now. So
one thing I noticed, just from seeing, I've taught in inner city schools for the most part, and seeing kids, just simple things, seeing kids, black and brown kids, skateboarding to school, That absolutely blew my mind. And it was, you know, maybe because I'm from an older generation and I was like, whoa, skateboarding. Like, I remember, we remember Lupe Fiasco, Kick Push, you know, and things like that. And but then to actually see it in practice, like kids from the hood skateboarding, was so cool to me. You know, when I was young, I might have been teased for that, you know. And I would talk to them about video games and they're like, oh, you're into video games. And initially it was me telling them this just so that they wouldn't feel that they were so different, you know, and that it was okay to be into those things. Like, I remember having to hide my Nintendo Power magazine and because I would get teased. People were like, oh, you nerd, what are you doing? You know? And so I would have those conversations with them and during like after school clubs or maybe lunch. I think lunchtime was some of the best times for me, where I would, of course, look forward to sitting alone and eating. But then over time, I would have kids who were like the different kids who were into the different things, who would then start asking me if they could stay in for lunch and just eat in my classroom. And so I would have a bunch of kids, and then it turned into, you know, from being like the outcast to being the cool kids club. You know, where I'd play them hip hop songs. I'd play them video game music soundtracks. We'd talk about games. We'd be able to have extracurricular chats that these kids took with them, and they would then become part of the cool circle because they're like, oh, remember that thing we talked about? And then more and more kids would want to stay. And to the point where like half my class wanted to stay in. And I'm like, no, guys, you got to go somewhere. I need a little bit of break from you guys. But yeah, just seeing those kids like eventually grow into their own and become comfortable with the things that they loved, you know, was really cool to me. And I tried my best to pull that out of them and to encourage it whenever I could. You know, I'd see little sketches in the margins of their books, little anime characters with the big eyes and things like that. And I'd make sure to encourage that gift, you know, because I knew, you know, just when I came up, there wasn't really much space for encouraging those talents, you know?
So now it's like, you know, you're teaching with doing hip hop on the side, and now you've combined your love of teaching, making people feel accepted and promoting positivity. Are you doing this kind of like in a KRS-One kind of way where you, hey, I'm going to teach while doing hip hop, or do you kind of approach it differently?
Well, I try not to approach it in that way. You know, I remember KRS calling an album Edutainment, and he calls himself the teacher. I try not to, but whenever I tell people just in passing, like, hey, I used to be a teacher, or, you know, teaching sometimes is still in me. So when I ask you guys to do something, like put your hands up or things like that, it's only because, you know, I'm used to being the boss. You know, I'll make jokes like that on stage. And afterwards, people will tell me like, oh, man, I know you say that you quit teaching, but you never did quit teaching. Like, you're just teaching through a different class from a different podium, you know? And it made me think like, wow, I guess that's true. You know, I hadn't really thought about it that way. I try to teach just through the best way possible. I think the best teachers are the ones that can teach you in a way where it doesn't feel like they're lecturing you. So I think teaching through the way I live, through the way I conduct myself, through the way I create music, through the way I'm, you know, positively uplifting my friends and building relationships with fans that are beyond, you know, the typical artist fan relationship. You know, I say that my fans are my family, you know, and it's true because, you know, I appreciate them for helping me to live my dreams. So therefore, we're like family, you know. There's always big hugs and there's conversations. There's how's the wife, how's the kids, you know. And, you know, I just think that being a living kind of testimony is the best way, you know, to continue that teaching. So it doesn't feel like a lecture, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. Because to release a song about classic literature, I always think, man, if I had to do a book report on Henry David Thoreau, I'm not doing that. But I learned more about it from that song than I ever had in years and years of literature classes. In fact, I had to Google the guy, and then, you know, all these figures like Ben Franklin, investor, philosopher, et cetera, et cetera. I learned Henry David Thoreau was a author, a poet, a philosopher, an abolitionist, tax resister, development critic, historian, you know. And then I look at Megaran, podcaster, comic books, video games, teacher, rapper. I see all the similarities where you don't have to compartmentalize all these different interests and professions. Is that why you resonate with these figures so much? Or is that a reach?
No, I think it's really accurate, man. Like, being able to go back, I think that's what the purpose and the best, I think the number one goal of this project, it turned out to be like a gift that kept giving, because I got a chance to research people who maybe I read their books, you know, because I had to through college, but going back and researching the actual author and what they were into when they wrote it and what, you know, what their philosophies were. And, you know, especially Thoreau being an abolitionist, you know, man, he wrote like fiery lectures, you know, that were, you know, anti-slavery. And, you know, so I was like, oh, this is perfect, you know. And civil disobedience is something that influenced Martin Luther King, Gandhi, you know, so many other people that were inspired by him. So I think that for us to call these people heroes, and I do call MLK a hero, I think it's important to look at their influences, you know. So Thoreau was one of those. So going through his works was a really great educational experience for me. Also, you know, a book that was written in the 1800s might not sound cool to a kid or even an adult who's into hip hop. So now I'm tasked with the job of trying to make this, you know, digestible, but also have deep meaning so it could be listened to more than once, so you could pick up more than one thing out of it. And so it was a great challenge for me. You know, anybody can write a song. I was about to say any idiot, but I just say anybody can write a song about how big the rims are on the car, or, you know, how they can take your girl, you know. But I think that making music that's a true like challenge is what I need to do for myself. I mean, as a guy who's been releasing music for over 10 years now, like, you got to find that new challenge. And I think that's what this is. I relate myself to Ryu at the end of Street Fighter 2, because he wins the tournament, but then he's not even there for the ceremony. You know, he's walking off looking for the next challenge. He's punching rocks by a waterfall, you know.
No doubt, man. Ryu should have been chilling in a hot tub with Chun-Li instead of just training all the damn time. That's just my opinion. But yeah, you're talking about like just constantly evolving. The last thing I wanted to talk about, man, Random Encounters, the podcast, man. If you start a podcast network, you got to recruit me, man, because I see an empire in the making here. It's numerous shows coming together.
I think we need to do that. Like, let's seriously chat about that. This was literally something that just popped off the top of my head while I was writing. I'm writing a book right now. Don't know the title. Don't know when it'll get done. It's basically my life story. I'm just making a bunch of notes, writing down every interesting story of things that have ever happened to me. So then I have a great editor. Shout out to Courtney working with me on this. And so she's kind of chopping off things that are a little extraneous or maybe just don't fit what I'm trying to tell, like the story I'm working towards. So these things, instead of ending up on the chopping room floor, I thought, you know what? I love audiobooks, but I also love really short stories. So I think that I'm going to take these stories, read them, and make a podcast out of them. And that's what I did. So far, we're two in. And another challenge for myself, just constantly trying to do something new. That's really what it was. And I really love it. I love the fact that it's really short. It's really easy. It's literally me just writing down a story to the best of my knowledge, and then reading it and speaking about it, and then working it into a narrative, which is what the lesson I've learned at the end of it. Which I think the best teachers are the best students, and that's really where this whole thing came from. Is that saying, you know, being that you got to be able to be a great learner if you can be a great teacher.
Yeah, I had this grand idea when I started this podcast, like maybe 2 years from now, I compile highlights from everyone that came on and maybe publish a book highlighting perspective or just verbal gems, because like you, like I'm just a big supporter of literacy, and I don't know, maybe you could write the foreword someday. But when that book comes out, man, I would love to just promote it and just be a part of all that. MegaRanMusic.com, MegaRanMerch.com, on social, MegaRan. As far as stopping the stage, giving you music, August 23rd, you'll be in Portland, which is going to lead into a short West Coast tour with Sky Blue. Wrestling podcast, Dewey Decimal System with MC Lars. Busy. Just busy, man.
Absolutely. Super busy. I'm actually trying to carve out time to write my next album. Like, I have concepts And like, I really want to kill it with this one. And it's just like, man, I got to find the time, you know, between all these other projects, I got to make the time to write this down. So, but the good news is there's no rush, you know, so I'm able to just jot down ideas. I go to the studio once a week. I just lay down like roughs and, you know, sketches. And then I come back to them later and I'm like, oh, that was horrible. You know, let me remove that. Or, oh, that was dope. Let me keep going, you know. So that's been really dope. So hopefully the book will be done by the end of the year. I'm trying to push for early next year and then an album and a tour with that as well. So, yeah, coming soon. More stuff.
And the annoying Black Materia, when's that coming? We're not going to get into that. All I want to say is I'm honored to get a color-coded block on your Google Calendar, my friend. I know you're busy, so thank you for your time.
Thank you for this. Like, I was looking forward to this chat, man. I love your interviews. I love that you're well-researched. You know what you're talking about. You ask great questions. So I couldn't possibly turn this down. So thanks for even asking to talk to me, man.
Damn, bro, made my day.
Nah, mine too.